So this is my last video on pipelining. We began with a very simple model and then we added layers of complexity. We talked about hazards and dependencies and so on. Okay, and early on we had this very simple model that said that if I break up my pipeline into n stages, I should expect roughly a speed up of n. Okay, and then we kind of modified that and said that, well, you know, because of the latch overhead, there are certain limits to how much throughput improvements you can see. Okay, but we did conclude that, you know, if this is performance and if this is number of stages, as I make my pipeline deeper and deeper, that is, as I add more stages, you know, performance goes up quite dramatically at first and then kind of tapers out. And this is, you know, it tapers out because of the latch overhead. Okay, so this is what we had decided earlier. Alright, now that we've talked about dependencies, I think we are in a position to refine this model a little bit more. Okay, so earlier we had assumed a perfect pipeline with no hazard, which meant that an instruction finished every single cycle. Okay, so if you ran your system for a million cycles, roughly a million instructions completed, right? And that gave you an IPC of 1. And so my speed up over an unpipelined processor was a function of the number of pipeline stages, which corresponds to the increase in clock speed. Now, when you have hazards and stalls, there are some cycles where nothing actually finishes. Okay, so you bring in instruction 1, then you bring in instruction 2, but it gets stalled. It gets stalled for, say, 2 cycles, and then it proceeds ahead and then it finishes, right? So 2 cycles go by where nothing useful gets done. Okay, so now the total number of cycles equals the number of instructions plus the total stall cycles. Okay, so CPI, which is cycles per instruction, equals 1 plus the stalls per instruction. Okay, so because of stalls, you know, my CPI goes from 1 to 1 plus stalls per instruction. Okay, so we really absolutely have to consider pipeline stalls to get a measure for overall performance and overall throughput. Okay, and I'm now going to show you that, you know, with this taken into account, my performance curve does not look like this. What it actually looks like is something that looks more like this. That is, as I make my pipeline deeper, performance improves, it hits an optimal point, and then it actually starts to degrade, right? So we have to realize that you can't pipeline forever, and that's why this is an important concept to understand and recognize. Okay, so let's see why the curve is going to have a shift like that. So what I'm going to do over here is I'm going to take an example. Here's my unpipelined processor. Okay, and let's say that I have a pair of instructions I1 and I2 which are independent. Okay, so I1 is doing R2 plus R3 into R1. I2 is doing R5 plus R6, write the result into R4. These two instructions are completely independent. Okay, so I will execute I1 over here. I'll execute I2 over here. I have no other option. And so the gap between the completion of two independent instructions is essentially this gap here, right? This one finished here, I2 finished here, and this gap equals T plus T overhead. Now let's take a pair of dependent instructions. Let's take I3 and I4, where I3, you know, writes into R1 and I4 reads from R1. Okay, again, I don't have any choice. I'm going to do, you know, I3 over here and I'm going to do I4 over here. The gap between dependent instructions is exactly the same. Now I move to a 3-stage pipeline. Okay, ABC. Let's take the gap between independent instructions, I1 and I2. So I1 starts over here and goes through stages ABC. Since I2 is independent, it can start right here, right? So I2 starts over here. It does A, B, and does C over here. So it finishes at this point. I1 finishes at this point. The gap between the completion times is T by 3, because I've taken this and broken it up into 3 stages, plus the T overhead of each stage, right? There's a latch sitting over here. So now the gap between these independent instructions, I1 and I2, is T by 3 plus T overhead. Now let's look at the gap between the dependent instructions I3 and I4. Okay, so let's say that um, So let's say that I3 begins over here, and let's say that this is my point of production. This is when I have a result. Okay, and if I assume that for I4 the point of consumption is early on, then I have to wait until C is done before I can start I4. I have to make sure that the C of I3 is done before I can start I4. Okay, so to make sure that the point of consumption happens after point of production, instructions have to be staggered this way, and the gap between the completion times of these two dependent instructions becomes T plus 3 times T overhead. That is, you have to do all of the circuit work, plus you have to go through the latch overhead of each of these three stages. Okay, so if I, you know, and if in this case I assume that the point of production happens at the very end of an instruction and the point of consumption happens at the very start, if you were to change this, if this was the point of production and this was the point of consumption, you would have a different set of equations, but you would still see this number kind of increasing because of all the intermediate pipeline stages and their latch overheads. Okay, so if I were to continue this example and, you know, go to a 6-stage pipeline, I would come up with these equations. Okay, so now let's observe what these equations are. If I assume that my program is full of independent instructions, then as I make my pipeline deeper, the gap between the completion times keeps on reducing. It goes from T to roughly T by 3 down to T by 6 and so on. So if I assume that my program is full of independent instructions, then my performance should have that curve like I showed you before. But on the other hand, if my program is full of dependent instructions, let's see how the gap between instructions changes. It goes from T plus T overhead to T plus 3 times T overhead to T plus 6 times T overhead. So as I make my pipeline deeper, it's actually taking me longer to finish each instruction. So if my program is full of dependent instructions, a deeper pipeline actually makes my throughput worse and worse. So the curve would be something like this. Okay, so pipelining actually hurts a program that is full of dependencies, right? And in reality, any program will have a mix of, you know, both dependencies and independent instructions. There will be some sequence of instructions where there'll be a chain of dependencies, and then there'll be some sequences of instructions where all instructions are independent. So ultimately, the eventual performance and the eventual curve will be a combination of these two curves, right? So it looks something like this. So as you increase the number of stages, the performance increases for a while, and then after some time it starts to go down because each additional stage is hurting your dependent instructions, and each additional stage is really not causing a huge improvement in performance because of the latch overheads. Okay, so there is an optimal point where you maximize performance, and if you go beyond that point, pipelining actually starts to hurt you. Right, so this is not a technique that you can use forever, right? And in most modern processors and most modern ISAs, it takes about 30 to 50 stages before you hit that optimal point. Okay, so this is a useful artifact to keep in mind, that pipelining is not this magic silver bullet which will keep giving you higher performance. There is a point beyond which you can actually start to degrade performance. Okay, and deep pipelines, of course, worsen your power consumption, because as you throw more circuits and as you throw more latches into your design, your power consumption needs also go up. Okay, so this ends our entire discussion on pipelining.